used to sing, "He's Still Working on Me." You remember that? That's older than the song you were referencing just a moment ago. And I'm not going to persecute you by singing that song for you. You probably know that song, "He's Still Working on Me." In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, it says that God began a work in you. And it also says that the same God who began that work in you will complete it. It is a real work. A lot of times our Christianity fails in terms of not being real. The reason that we did the bugs versus the other creature is one is real and one is not. There's a difference between a miracle that the Bible talks about and magic that you can see on television every day. Magic on television is an illusion. It really doesn't happen that a woman gets sawed in half. It just appears that she gets sawed in half. There's a difference between an illusion or magic and the real thing. We live a lot of times in the realm of our imagination. Batman. Do you like Batman? I like Batman. I wish I could be Batman. I don't just like watching him. I enjoy what he can do and the gadgets that he has. My goodness, how many gadgets does he have? And then there's Spider-Man, who hangs upside down. I'd like to hang upside down just one time, voluntarily, hang upside down just one time and do everything that he does. And when Captain America came down the pike, I thought I had died and gone to heaven, because here is an American hero who always does the right thing. He's so clean cut, and he stays away from the girls, and obviously all the girls like Captain America, but they all have the same thing in common. They are fantasy people. On television, we watch and engage in fantasies all the time. For example, yesterday is a football day. Today actually would be a football day as well. And then tomorrow night will be a football night as well. I'm not sure where the football stops, but once it gets started, it's always there. You know what? It's amazing to me, and this is real. It's amazing to me how they can get knocked crazy. A lineman can hit a quarterback and knock him crazy, and he just stands up and walks away. I remember when I broke my hip several years ago, I fell off a roof, and I only fell about that far and hit just right and broke my hip. And my first thought was, well, I see them do this on football day all the time. They just get up and they brush it off and go on. But not me. It didn't happen that way for me. It happens for them if it doesn't for me. But we engage in a lot of things that are not real. I'm afraid sometimes we engage in a Christianity that is not totally, completely real. And so we're going to get a dose of reality today, but it's a good thing. The real thing is God started a work in you, and God is still working a work in you. And God will complete that work when you go to heaven, and will, I believe, continue. This is just me. I believe there'll be things for us to do in heaven to serve him and to praise him there. I'm not sure what that will be, but I believe that God will use us in that way there. Are you at Philippians 1:6? Turn to Philippians 1:6 and stand. Let's read God's word together. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. And stay, remain standing. We're going to read chapter 3 as well, part of chapter 3. Verse 6 in chapter 1 says, "Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." Now, if you'll turn the page in my Bible, you have to turn one page, chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. Paul said this about himself. He said, "Not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." So he's in the process of taking hold of something for which he was saved, or Christ took hold of him. "Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of this, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And so there's a process there. God is doing that work. And then in chapter 3, Paul understood that there was something for him to do in that process, cooperating with God as God did what he wanted to in his life. Father, we pray you bless the reading and the study of your word. We ask God that it would enrich us in our souls and our spirits. We pray that your word would change us mentally, emotionally, spiritually, in every way. And we pray that when people look at our lives, they could see the change that you're working out in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We have some assumptions and expectations about the church. One of the assumptions is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, where it says there that he has made us a new creature. That's the general small phrase that's there. One of the assumptions that we make is that once he's done that, it's done forever, and we are completely changed forever. And in effect, we, I think, are. But it's we take that to mean without any time, it's kind of like magic, without any effort on our part. But if you read God's Word, and I know all of you do, and study God's Word, you understand there's a process involved with that. There are, I believe, some problems involved in this, and that is that whole idea. All you have to do is just pray, and just pray that one time, and you're changed forever, which is true. But at the same time, it doesn't work that Christian character in our lives that we know is very, very important. So I'm slicing a little bit thin. Let me use this example for you. For a long time, we've had this idea in our mind that if an alcoholic receives Christ, then the taste of alcohol will leave them. And that happens sometimes. But the vast majority of the people that I've dealt with in my years of ministry has not been that way. As they've received Christ, the Lord has blessed their hearts, forgiven them their sins, given them a brand new life. But they had to struggle as they gave up that alcohol because they still had leanings in that direction. I know it happens all the time that things change like that, but it doesn't always, it's just not always that way. Our family has certain expectations of us that sometimes, and once again, I'm still thinking about the alcoholic. The family says, well, I thought he got saved, and yet he is still struggling with this. Well, having worked in mental health centers for years and years and years, kind of as a side job for several years, worked with them, the idea is that a lot of times a person will give up alcohol, and they'll stay dry for 6 months, and then they'll go back on alcohol, and then they'll give it up again, and they'll stay dry for 12 months. Usually it starts out small, a small dry period, a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, bigger. It takes a process there to give it up. And so some of our assumptions are not necessarily correct. Now, here's an assumption. Since I struggle with my Christianity, I must not be saved. The idea is if I have problems with sin, if I still sin in my life, or if there's something that's pervading sin, it just comes back and back and back, I must not be saved. Well, there's some truth in this. There are some people who, even though they walk the aisle or even though they get in the water, they're really not saved. And all of us know that. But you can be saved and still have a struggle with the sin in your life. After all, the book of Galatians teaches us that the flesh strives against the spirit. There's a warfare that goes on. In Romans chapter 7, Paul referenced this. He said, the things that I want to do, I don't do. So there was a struggle in his life. We struggle, if you'll think about it with me for just a moment, we struggle with Satan. When we turn our lives over to Jesus, Satan comes after us because we're on the opposite team now from him. We struggle with the world culture in which we live. You turn on your television, it's shoving you in this direction, shoving you in this direction, shoving you in this direction. And the only shove you get in the Jesus direction is what you get at church, what you get from a Christian radio station, or perhaps what you get from a Christian friend. They push you in the Jesus direction, but the rest of the culture in which we live are moving in this direction. And then we struggle with our own flesh within us, or our selfishness there. Satan is an illusionist. He's a magician. He is a liar. He is a confuser. And he's going to continue to do that on and on and on. So our assumptions are very often incorrect. And that doesn't mean that there's not some bit of truth in them. You know, the best lies have some truth within them. But then I think Americans as well are soft. We quit easily. We start something and we stop it. We don't want to burden ourselves with any struggle or conflict. It's all about being comfortable. Sometimes it's all about being whatever works good for us. But here's an example, and let me throw this example at you, and we'll move on to the next point. Let's just suppose that I broke my head, a wrist, right here. I broke my wrist. And I go to the doctor, and he's probably going to put a cast on that wrist. And I'm thinking, I say something to him like, well, now, how long is this cast going to be on my wrist? And he says it takes 6 weeks for a bone to heal. And so I get, you know, the cast off in 6 weeks, and my wrist won't move like this. And he says something like this. He says, oh, you got to go to therapy. What does he mean? He means that it got stiff in the 6 weeks. It didn't take long for a wrist to get stiff, actually. It didn't take long for bones to get stiff at all. But there's that ongoing therapy that you need, and if you don't get it, you will stiffen up, and it will never be like it used to be. But just because it's healed doesn't necessarily mean it still has the full range of motion. And if you don't get the therapy, we all know what happens if you don't do the therapy. You're going to be like that for the rest of your life until you die. That's just the hard, cold truth. And so I use that illustration to say to you that we make an assumption that we'll be well and we're not going to have to do anything on our own part. And that's what I mean by soft Americans. American people believe that there's some pill for just about everything. And the doctors, when they don't give us some pill, if they require something out of us, oh, by the way, you need to get some exercise, you need to work with a physical therapist to get your range of motion back, we assume that somehow or another that's not going to be necessary. We make some of the same kinds of assumptions when it comes to Christianity. Well, let's talk about the real world. When I say real, I mean the scientific, observable world in which we live. I mean exactly what the scientists say they believe in on television, they don't always believe in it. I mean something that's visible with our eyes. If a person, man or woman, is really saved, then that should be really observable in some way. That person should begin to change the words that they use. If they're a bad cusser, they should start bleeding off those cussing words. Amen? So you need to drop those cussing words. If you're a cusser, you need to drop those because you're saved now. That's one thing. We live out our faith, and we grow in what we do. The world, real world is gray. I've heard people say a lot of times that it's gray, and there is a right and wrong, but sometimes it's not easily observed. Sometimes we have to exercise our faith. The book of Hebrews, I thought about reading this one, I'm putting it on PowerPoint, but you know, you put so much on PowerPoint, it gets a bit confusing to you. But the book of Hebrews says that we become exercised in our faith. And it means not like an exorcist, it means like we exercise our faith. And we learn right and wrong. And we learn right and wrong over a period of time. There's not only right and wrong, but all of us know there's wise and there's foolish. There are things that are not necessarily so wrong. You know, I'm a very black and white person. But there's a lot of areas that are wise and foolish, and that's the reason we have the book of Proverbs. Because that's wisdom that we need, that wisdom. There are things that are appropriate and things that are inappropriate. I believe we can talk about just about everything, but there are times and places that are appropriate to talk about things and times and places that are not. There's mature and immature. When my children were young and they said something immature, I thought to myself, they're immature. They're just kids. They don't quite understand those things. The Bible says, approve things that are excellent, good and excellent. There's good and bad, yes, but there's good and there's better and there's best. Now, let me give you this illustration, and some of these illustrations you just need to chew on a little bit when you get home. This here's one of them. There. If you are wronged by someone, and that happens from time to time. Anybody in here ever been wronged by someone? Say amen. That's what I thought. I thought most of us have been wronged somewhere along the line. Well, here you have some options. Well, first of all, the first option is just don't have anything to do with that person for the rest of your life. There's an option for you. I didn't get an amen on that. A better option would be to forgive that person, right? Forgive that person. But the best option would be perhaps to not only forgive that person, but to talk to that person and say to them, go to the person who's wronged you perhaps and say, I felt a little wronged right there. Let's talk about it. And in that scenario, you could help that person to grow as a Christian person. What about witnessing? It's always right to witness, right? It is always right to witness. But how you witness, when you witness, and the finesse, there's a certain finesse that goes with witnessing so that you can tell somebody, hey, you're a sinner and you're going to hell, but you don't say it in that way. I talked to a guy in my very first church, and he said, I need you to come over here and talk to me. He said, my brother told me I was going to hell. So I knew it would be a wonderful visit. So I did the trail over there, and we sit down. He said, and he was mad as a wet hen. He said, my brother told me I was going to hell. What do you think? And so, I didn't know what to say. So this is what I said. I said, well, the Bible teaches us that there are some people going to hell and there's some people going to heaven. I said, let me tell you how you can go to heaven. So I told him how you could go to heaven. And I said, now you have to decide. Are you going to heaven or are you going to hell? That's how I answered that question. I was young and dumb. I'm old and dumb now, but I was young and dumb then. And we had to, you know, it's a witnessing thing. You have to learn how to say something in the most appropriate way, but with the truth involved in that, because we're committed to the truth. The truth is we have a real enemy. He's not able to possess you. Satan cannot possess you, but he can harass you and oppress you. The truth is, according to the Word of God, according to the life of Jesus Christ, he tempts those, even those who are really good people, Satan tempts day after day. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, it says we wrestle against the wiles of the devil. We struggle, in other words, with that. He says in the Bible, the letter is a great place to look for this, that he divides this person against this. So he cannot unsave us. I'm going to say it that way. The devil cannot unsave you, but he can discourage you. He can steal your Christian joy. He can steal your Christian wisdom. He can confuse you about right and wrong. And the more you watch television, the more confused you'll be. And why is that, do you think? The more you read the Bible, the less confused you'll be. Why is that? Because the devil is involved with confusion there. Have you come to grips, I hope that you have, with a real devil? He is not a magician, a miracle worker, even though I think he does do miracles in Scripture. That's another sermon. But he's mostly an illusionist. He's a liar in that way. So a real Christian, if you'll think with me for just a moment, a real Christian struggles with Satan and struggles with sin. A real Christian is persecuted, you know, kind of like Jesus was persecuted. Was he persecuted because he did not do the right thing, or was he persecuted because he did do the right thing? A real Christian is sometimes killed or imprisoned, even though in our country that rarely happens here. A real Christian struggles with the flesh, I believe, from morning to night. A real Christian sins. Even Paul said that he was the chief of sinners. Now, put that in your pipe and smoke it, as we used to say. You know, there's just a real interesting idea there. It's not easy to be a Christian because the devil will not leave you alone. It's not easy to be a Christian because you are different from this world. Our calling is different from this world. Several years ago, a man in our church who raised quail for a living. He had big, long quail houses, kind of like a chicken house, but longer. And the reason they made their chicken house, their quail houses longer, was so that the quails could learn to fly. And he would sell them to game preserves. They would take the quails and turn them loose in the game preserve so that men could go in there and hunt quail. And it was a lucrative business. Actually made a whole lot of money doing that. And I asked him one day, his name is Clyde, gone to be with the Lord now, and he's a great guy, even though we didn't agree on a lot of things. He didn't like me, and sometimes I didn't like him. Amen? Okay. I didn't get any support on that right there. But anyway, I said, Clyde, do you ever have albino quail? He said, we have them all the time. It's just a fact of nature that albino quail happen. I said, really? And I said, what do they look like? He said, well, he said, I'll show you one sometime if you're down at the house. But he said, they don't last long. I said, what do you mean? He said, the other quail pecks them to death. And I said, why? And he said, because they're different. God has called you as a Christian to be different. And the very fact that you are different will mean that Satan will persecute you. Our calling is different. Our calling is not to be a human being. Human beings are just basically naturally apathetic. Our calling is to be moral? No. That would mean that you give good for good. Our calling is so high that when people are bad to us, we're supposed to be good back. That's the difference. So that's the real Christian world in which we live. And then there's the real church. You put all those struggling people together that we just mentioned a while ago, and you have the real church. The real church is sometimes messy. Paul said it this way. He said there are four types of people in God's church. They're the lost. This is 1 Corinthians 3. They're the lost people, and then they're the saved people. There are two types of people there. But he also mentioned the baby Christians, the infant Christians, the immature Christians, saved but not grown up. You know what happens to all those 9-year-old boys and girls who come to Vacation Bible School and then don't ever come back to church? They just are raised by parents who don't take them to church. And because they're raised by parents who don't take them to church, they wind up being adult Christian babies. They're babies in their Christian faith because they've not been given an opportunity to grow up in the Lord. So there are three types there, the lost and the saved and the babies. And the fourth type is the carnal Christian. Now, I had a lady tell me not too many years ago that there is no such thing as a carnal Christian. She said, the word carnal and Christian do not go together, if you go by words. And I said, really? And she said, yeah. She said, I heard it from a preacher on the internet. And I said, okay. And I was trying to figure this out, and she said, I'll bring you a tape. So she brought me a tape, and I listened to it. It's about an hour and a half sermon. So that was a difficult job for me to listen to an hour and a half sermon. I don't even listen to myself for an hour and a half. And so I listened to the sermon, and God went to great depths to say that all those people who are carnal Christians were lost. They're not saved. And I beg to differ. I beg to differ because in the Bible, I'm not listening to the preachers. I'm listening to the Bible. And in the Bible, Paul is the one who came up with carnal Christians. That is, people who are truly saved, but they live like the world. They're fleshly. That's what carnal means. Chili con carne, chili with meat, you know, that's what that means. So they're fleshly Christians, and that's what Paul said. And so, yes, it's real. It's true. There are people who don't live like the Lord wants them to live, but they wind up in churches all over the place. Now, what are the problems of the church? Well, we've got all kinds. We've got leadership problems. Jesus warned us about false prophets. Do you remember that? That's leadership. Okay. The Pharisees, you know what they were? Leaders. The hirelings. Jesus warned us about the hirelings. That's those who are leaders for hire. They flee when the wolf comes because they're just there for the money. I know that you don't know of anybody, or you've never heard of a person in a leadership position in the church who did it for the money. I know you've never heard of that, right? I'm being sarcastic. What about those who are wolves who just eat up the sheep? Jesus warned us about those as well, and we could go on. And then we have philosophy problems nowadays. People are really in love more with ideas, and it comes out as theology, but it's just ideas. The book of Colossians warns us about ideas and getting into philosophies. We don't have the time to go there. The idea, folks, and I call the idea, folks, in the church, the coffee cup Christians. Those who sit around and drink coffee and talk about being Christian. That's a good idea. That's a good idea. But you rarely see anything. We just talk about being Christian. It makes us feel good to run a clever new idea. It has to be new ideas, you know. That old stuff, that's not the good stuff. I've come to believe that the old stuff is the good stuff. We just added ideas across the way. But they're idea, folks. So we have philosophy problems. And then we've got immorality problems in the church. I know you've never heard of that. Immorality in the church. Like sexual harassment within the church from leadership people or other people. And I could give you some examples, but they might be listening over the internet, even as I speak. We have, nowadays, we have pedophiles in the church. They've been in the church for years and years and years, but they are still there. Just because we're very educated about it does not mean that they're not there. And then we have the immorality problems of incest. 1 Corinthians 5, Paul dealt with incest there. So that's a problem there. 1 Peter talks about the problem of being submitted to leadership. What kind of leadership? And I would just say all kinds of leadership. Leadership within the church, leadership outside the church. The leadership of the governmental bodies. Peter suggested that we submit to these areas. Leadership within the home, parents over children, husbands and wives. And so you've got all kinds of things there. And so you put all those in the mix, and we've got a problem. And then there are the real apostles of the Bible. For example, Peter. It was Peter, the best apostle that Jesus had, arguably, who Jesus turned to and said, "Get behind me." It was Peter who denied that he even knew Jesus Christ. What about the apostle Paul? And one of my favorite lines about Paul didn't say this, but it was said about him, they said that there was no small contention between him and Mark. No small contention. You know what that means in Alabama language? That means they didn't like each other, they had a fight. No small contention. I think they worked it out. Peter and Paul didn't see eye to eye on the Gentiles, on how to receive the Gentiles in. Peter finally came around. What about the apostle Thomas? He, first of all, was not there. Everybody else was there when Jesus came back. And so the question that everybody asks is, hey, where's Thomas? And the idea that we're given from Scripture is we don't know where he was the first time. When Jesus came back, Thomas was there the second time. The apostle Judas, and I will use that word about him, the apostle Judas, obviously he fell by the wayside, he betrayed the Lord. What about the apostle Matthew? The apostle Matthew was a tax collector. You put all these together with people who are not filled with the Spirit. The very idea that you have to be exhorted to be filled with the Spirit means that so many people are not. Within God's church, these are leadership folks, and they had to work through this, and none of this was right. I'm not saying any of this was right. I'm saying, though, that it's a process. Within God's church, there are those who are weak. The King James Version calls them the faint-hearted. I like faint-hearted. The bruised, emotionally, spiritually, perhaps bruised because of something that's happened to them in their lives or in the church or perhaps even both. I had a doctor friend who told me once, he said, "You'd be amazed how many people who show up at your church Sunday after Sunday who are on depression medicine." He said, "The world is full of people who are depressed." I believe that, don't you? I believe that. So we're weak in that way. There's the hurting. Someone dies in their family, and you just don't get over that overnight. Sometimes it takes a year, 3 years. What am I saying? Sometimes it takes 30 years to get over that when someone dies. What about the enslaved? In our churches, we have those who are enslaved with drugs. We have those who are enslaved with gambling. We have those who are enslaved with pride. It's all about me. You know the pride people, because they're always saying, I. You start counting how many times you use the word I, and listening to how many times other people use the word I. We are pretty much full of ourselves. Amen? Well, let's move on. What about those who are just evil? Are there any of those in the church? I believe that there are. And so you look at all that and you say, what a mess. That's what I say. I say, what a mess. All the ideas, all the leadership problems. It's amazing that we get along as well as we do. But I'm just making the point, and I pulled some places from Scripture. We could go on for 2 hours in this way. It was there in Jesus' day, and it's there in our day. And that doesn't necessarily mean that these people are lost necessarily. That's God's call anyway. It's not our call. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're lost. Maybe they're wounded. And so following Jesus is a process. We say, get saved. Jesus didn't say it that way. Jesus said this. He said, follow me. Getting saved is a one-time event. You can put that on the church roll and you send it in to the Baptist hierarchy so they could say, whoa, we had lots of people saved last year. You know, it's not about just getting saved. It's about following Jesus day after day after day. We say, get saved. But Jesus said, make disciples. You see the difference there? Making disciples is a process. It happens over a period of time, and I think there's some ups and downs there. So I want to throw four pictures at you, and the first picture is the molding process. Jeremiah chapter 18, there is the picture of the potter. He's got his hands on the clay and the little pot, and the clay's moving around and around. They do that with their foot in their day. But they turn it around and around, and they're molding, and they're molding, and they're molding. And that's an illustration or an analogy for us of what God is doing in our life. God is not finished with you. He's molding you. And just because you have some problem in your life, and you go back to Jeremiah 18. We just don't have time to read all the scripture. Go back to Jeremiah 18. When there's some problem in the clay, the potter doesn't just throw out the clay, but he does start all over again with the same clay. He starts all over again, and he molds, and he molds, and molds. And one of the things I want you to know is that potter has something in mind. He has a vision for the clay or the mud. It's just mud in my Alabama way of looking at things. It's just mud, but he wants to mold it into something very pretty. In Romans chapter 8, verse 29, it says, God has predestined us to be conformed to the image of Jesus. That's where he's going with your life, that you will look more like Jesus. The second idea here, or the second process, is the growing process. Matthew 13, it talks about planting seed and growing up. Some seed is fruitful, Matthew 13. Some seed is not fruitful. Some seed falls in weedy soil. That doesn't necessarily mean that that person is unsaved, but they're not fruitful. Have you ever known a Christian who you really felt like was saved, but they were not fruitful? That's because they let the weeds, the cares of this world grow up. This is Matthew 13. Go home and read it when you get home today. It doesn't necessarily mean we're unsaved. An immature plant, for example, tomato. An immature tomato will not produce tomatoes yet. Yes, it has to have about 3 months. I think it's 3 months. What about this? The transforming process. Romans 12, 1 through 2. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind. Romans 1, 12, 1 and 2. By the renewing of your mind. And so the idea is you go move from an egg to a butterfly. But there are stages in this transforming process. An egg is transformed into a worm. We call it a caterpillar. The caterpillar is transformed into a cocoon. And then the cocoon is transformed into a beautiful butterfly, but there's a process there. And so Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, he says, I'm trying to become what I was apprehended of God to be. He's becoming what God saved him to be. And here's the fourth one, the maturing process. December 24, 2006, we got a dog at our house. That's right, it was Christmas Eve. I'm not thinking dog, but my children are. Now, my daughter's not here when she comes back in. We'll be talking about her when she comes back in. So they had to have a dog. So we called the shelter in Florence, and guess what? They were closed on Christmas Eve. Anybody with the right mind would be closed on Christmas Eve, right? So we called the Muscle Shoals shelter, and that's where we get our dog. We drove all the way from Florence, all the way over here, and she turned the puppies loose in the backyard. You never seen so many puppies in all your life. There were 1,000 puppies in the backyard. There really weren't 1,000. It just looked like that, and it smelled like that, too, frankly. And so, you know, have all these puppies, and we picked out this dog, and we took it home, and guess what? The moment he walked into our house, he started chewing on things. He chewed the rug, put him in the garage. He demolished the garage, brought him back in the house. And when he got back in the house, he left any number of surprises for us all along the way. Amen? And guess who gets to clean up the surprises? Well, of course, the old man. That's the old man's job, to clean up the surprises, right? When we were in that process and working through all the tore-up things and the stinky things, my children kept saying the same thing. He's just a puppy. He's just a puppy. And it finally dawned on me that this is not an aberration. This is not something that is not supposed to happen. This is normal for a puppy. A 6-week, 8-week-old puppy is supposed to do all these things. I learned that day that there are a lot of people who are just puppies. Maybe they've never been taught, never been trained. Maybe they have been taught or they have been trained and they didn't take it. You know, you can give somebody training and they don't receive it. It happens all the time. So, the problem that we have is not new. And just because someone doesn't act saved, in our point of view, doesn't necessarily mean that they are not saved. We're called to struggle. We're called to be different from the world in which we live, to be like that quail that was an albino quail. We're called not only to be different, we're called to be ambassadors for the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, there is darkness all around us in the world in which we live. People think dark. They're just not acting dark. They think dark, but you are the light of the world. You're called to be different. To have a different attitude, to have a different heart, to walk on a different pathway, and in the process of that, to shine for Jesus. So, my challenge to you as we conclude this morning is just be the light. Just be the light. People need examples to go towards. That's in the maturing process. People need to understand that it's not just getting your name on a church roll. We're making disciples. This is huge. This is big. People need to hear the gospel, because when they turn on their television, they ain't getting the gospel. Excuse me for just saying it in Alabama land. They're getting a lot else on TV, but they're not getting the gospel. Where are they going to get it? They're going to get it from you. Where are they going to see it? They're going to see it in you, if they see it at all. That is our call, to shine like Jesus. Father, I pray you help us to be more and more like you. God, there are people who